Okay, now we can stand for the word. Now we can stand for the word. Doing a lot of up and down today. Got to keep you guys alert. Got to keep you guys awake. While you're standing, can we honor our elder, Elder Andy, for being here tonight? Always a blessing to have him. And was that not a beautiful transition by Steph this in the middle of service? Incredible. And how about back-to-back weeks? Where's my homie Peyton for doing a great job for first-time guests? Where are you? Good job, girl. Up-and-coming communicators. Wait till you guys see Renee. He has props and stuff, so you'll hear more about that. John chapter 10. Chris, after this, we'll have the video ready. I'll give a little intro to it. John chapter 10, I'm reading one verse, and it might be a little different than it is on the screen. John chapter 10, I'm reading one verse, verse 27. And it says this: my sheep listen to my voice, I know them, and they follow me. My sheep listen to my voice, I know them, and they follow me. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for the fact that we get to gather here and enjoy ourselves. We get to enjoy each other, but more than anything, we get to hear from you. We get to learn about you. We get to fall more in love with you, and we get to hear about how in love with us that you are. So, Lord, we just ask that your word is clear to us tonight, that we can leave here closer to you and going in the direction to the purpose and destiny that you have designed for us. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so I hope this video works, but have you guys ever watched those videos where, like, depending on the word you're looking at, that's what you hear? You guys ever seen one of those? Okay, I sent one to the AV team. I don't know if this is going to work, but we're going to give it a shot. Did that work on you guys? It worked on me. I'm not gonna lie. I don't know how many times I watched that video. Like, all the views are me. I'm not kidding. But it's interesting how that works. And that's a super cool video. I don't know the science behind it or anything like that. But have you ever found yourself in that situation where you can only hear what you're listening to hear? Have you ever been in a position? Have you ever been in a conversation with someone and you hear them and they're talking and you can hear everything they say, but you're not listening to what they say, and it's like a super intense story? What's the appropriate response when they're done? That's crazy. Like, dang, bro. Whoa. Right? She's nuts. You know, like, no clue what they're saying. But I believe that is something that's common. I believe we've all been in those situations where we hear something, but we're not listening, or we even want to hear something or someone, but we position ourselves to hear, but not to listen and to gather in. So what we're going to talk about tonight is just, it's not a foreign concept. It's not a far-fetched thought, but I do have a series of questions I want to ask you guys before we dive into this, because if these questions aren't thought-provoking to you, at least to a certain degree, I don't know if we need to have this conversation. And I really think tonight's more of a monologue than a dialogue, so it's okay if you guys talk back to me a little bit. I'm not saying you have to critique what I'm saying or set up an argument like the little girl did at camp, but I mean at conference, but you guys get what I'm saying. Like, we can be in a conversation here to a certain degree. So how many of you believe that God is real? Good. We're doing a show of hands. Good. Most of you guys believe that God is real. How many believe God is good? So far, so good. How many believe that God has ways of speaking to people? We're off to a good start. How many of you honestly can say that you said yes to the previous question, but you have trouble hearing God? Oh, the rest of you guys are so saved. My goodness. Okay, some of you guys have trouble hearing God. How many of you can say that you've honestly found ways that you believe that you can hear God? Good, good. That's a good thing. Higher, 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 higher. Okay, these are our new group leaders. Go sit with them. Follow them. That's good. I love that. For those of us that do have at times have trouble hearing God, I want to challenge you tonight that there I don't believe in this day and age, in with us being this modern New Testament church, a church that is filled with the Spirit of God, if you understand what that means, a church that has the Bible and all of the Word of God that He so gracefully allowed us to have. I don't believe we're in an era or a season where God isn't speaking. I believe actually we're in a season where God is constantly speaking. And the issue when we're having trouble hearing God is that even as He speaks, we're not listening. In fact, some of you guys are hearing me and not listening to me right now. That's just honest truth. You're looking at your phones. You're having your own conversations. You're thinking about something different. You're comparing whatever is on the screen and wondering if that person texts back, or wonder if that person followed you back, or wondering why your phone's so dry, or whatever else. And you're hearing me, but you're not listening. And oftentimes, you are the same hand that goes up and says, I really have trouble hearing God. I really have trouble knowing what the Bible says. I really have trouble understanding the Bible. But there's times when you get in position where you can hear the Word of God or the preached Word of God or a God-ordained word, but you've made a choice not to listen. And as ranty as this sounds like it could be, I am concerned about this setting here, but I'm more concerned about the moments where you think you can't hear God even when you're alone. Where you think you can't hear God, even in the toughest moments, maybe those times where you're praying so hard over that math or English test, you know, when you're like, God, where are you? So I just want to dive into that a little bit. So before I do that, I think it's important for you guys to understand that the things that we preach and talk about here is always rooted in what we call foundational truths in Scripture. Matter of fact, if it's not, Elder Andy will pull me to the side as soon as I'm done and say, hey, brother, never again. But so when we have these talks, it's not something I'm making up. And also, it's not something that someone just taught me and I took their word for it. We believe that what we do and what we say and how we present what we communicate should be rooted in Scripture. So I'm going to read you a few verses. I'm going to read you a few. Matter of fact, Crelia, come read this verse for me. Come read this verse for me. Get some interaction today.
So faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ.
Beautiful. It said faith comes through hearing. Faith comes through. Faith comes through. Faith comes through. And there's nothing to hear if he's not talking. So faith comes through hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. We good? I was going to pick on someone else, but I better keep going. Jeremiah 33:3 says this, call to me and I will answer you, and I will tell you the great and hidden things that you have not known. Mysteries. Do we believe there's mysteries in the world? There's mysteries on earth? Like, I think there's mysteries in terms of some of the things and negative and how is it that happened to that person. I think some of those things are mysteries, but I also think there's simple mysteries that you guys are wondering all the time, like, God, what do you want me to be doing with my life? And I think there's a specific reason why God doesn't just give you this playbook or handbook at the beginning of your life, because he actually wants to talk you through it. Karine and I don't leave a note for our 6-year-old and 8-year-old every day of how their day should go. We sit and talk with them. We sit and hang out with them. We talk about it on the way to school in the car. And instructions are good. Written instructions are good and they're helpful. But hearing the voice of your parent and from us with God, hearing the voice of our Father is much more comforting and much more confident than just trying to get these pre-given instructions. So the truth is, God could have probably laid out some of the mysteries and some of the things about our life a lot easier, but I think he wants to put us in the position where we can hear his voice. One more verse says this, John chapter 8, verse 47. It says, whoever is of God hears the words of God. The reason why you do not hear them is that you are not of God. That's a little tough one, but it's honest truth. The Bible makes it pretty clear, and even the first verse that we read, it says, my sheep hear my voice and they know me and I know them. The thing is, in order to hear God's voice, you have to be one of his children. Now, I think there's times where God stops people dead in their tracks when they're running far from him, but what God does before he speaks to you is he selects you. God selects you, God draws you, and God speaks to you. So here are some of the what we do's, and when I say we, I mean even myself. There's times I'm prepping for a message, supposed to be doing a devotional, or even a bunch of different things. There's times where I'm not hearing the voice of God clearly, and when you're a part of a team leading 100 wild teenagers, you need to hear the voice of God a lot, all right? But this is some of the things that we do. Number one, we check out / don't pay attention. That's one of the things that we often do. We check out or we don't pay attention. I don't mean just when we're sitting here listening to a message, but just in seasons of life, we're like, man, oh shoot, that Bible reading plan, I'm 10 days behind. And it was a 10-day plan, you know? Like you just check out and you're not paying attention anymore. Number two, we only hear what we want to hear. We only listen to what we want to hear. All right? Another one. Sometimes we're hearing the voice of God and don't know we're hearing it. Sometimes God is speaking to us and we don't realize that's what's going on. I'll explain a little bit of that. And then another last thing that we do is we hear, but we don't apply it. We know it's God saying it. We know, like, man, we know. First, we just think it's ourself, and then we just think it's instincts, and then think it's intuition, and then God just keeps confirming it, and we're like, I'm gonna pass. That's just myself. Behind me, devil, you know? I wanna talk to you guys just briefly about a young man that heard the voice of God and how he got to that point. I'm gonna give a little background. His name is Samuel. Anybody heard of Samuel in the Bible? Heard of Samuel? One saved, two saved, go girl. There's a book of Samuel that's written after him, but a little background, his mom was named Hannah, and his mom was very, I don't want to use the word desperate, but she really wanted to have a child. And she was faithful to go to the house of God, she was faithful in prayer, and there's a whole cool story behind it, but one thing that we came to the understanding is that Hannah couldn't have children for one reason or another, and the husband she was with, you know, this is an Old Testament story, so he was able to have kids with his other wife, but not able to have kids with her. And there's even a specific story that's shared with vivid detail just about Hannah absolutely crying out to God to have a child. I mean, that they're talking about the fervor that she had in prayer in the moment. And it's probably one of the more detailed prayer moments that you see described in the Bible. And she's just really bombarding heaven regarding having this child. And finally, she makes this statement. She says, God, if you give me a child, I will give him back to you. And not just give him back to you in terms of like, I'm gonna make sure to raise him as a good godly child. This is the commitment that she made. If you give me a child, in other words, this is what she was saying, I will have this kid raised at the church. Like that serious. Like there's prophets, there's leaders. Like she said, if you give me this child will not only be dedicated to you, mind, heart, soul, but literally will live, be raised in your house. And that's exactly what happened. Samuel was born. She raised him to use the word weaned, until he's weaned off his mother, to where basically he can function slightly independently, and at least as he's raised by an adult. And then he moved in with this prophet by the name of Eli. So I'm going to read this story real quick, about 10 verses, and it says this. So now Samuel's a young boy in the house of God. Meanwhile, the boy Samuel served the Lord by assisting Eli. Now, in those days, messages from the Lord were very rare, and visions were quite uncommon. One night, Eli, who was almost blind by now, had gone to bed. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was sleeping in the tabernacle near the ark of God. Now, mind you, this is before Jesus came, so there were so many different rules, and in order to be near the presence of God, you had to be near this thing called the ark, and eventually we'll break all that down for you guys, but just know he was in the presence of God. Suddenly, the Lord called out, Samuel! Yes, Samuel replied. What is it? He got up and ran to Eli. He said, here I am. Did you call me? Eli's like, I didn't call you. Go back to bed. So he did. Then the Lord called out again, Samuel. Again, Samuel got up and went to Eli. Here I am. Did you call me? And Eli said, I didn't call you, my son. Go back to bed. Samuel did not yet know the Lord because he had never had a message from the Lord before. So the Lord called a third time. I actually want to catch what was said in verse 7. It says, Samuel did not yet know the Lord because he had never had a message from the Lord before. What that verse is saying is that he never heard the voice of God before, so he didn't recognize the voice of God. At this point, he's hearing the voice of God, but he didn't recognize the voice of God, right? So the Lord called a third time, and once more Samuel got up and went to Eli. He said, here I am, did you call me? He was probably pretty irritated by now. Eli probably too, because he keeps getting woken up by this kid who he's not yelling for. Then Eli realized it was the Lord who was calling the boy. So he said to Samuel, go and lie down again. And if someone calls again, say, speak, Lord, your servant is listening. So Samuel went back to bed. And the Lord came and called as before, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel replied, speak, your servant is listening. So I just want to talk to you guys for a few minutes about the difference between hearing and listening. I firmly believe that we're in a society, in an era, in a season, maybe I guess in a moment of time, where we need to hear God like never before. And I'm sure this has been said probably in every single era, but this is the one that I'm in, so I think it's the most crucial. All right, this is the one I'm raising my kids in, so I feel like it's the most crucial. But there's also a lot of Bible that just talks about the days that we're living in now. And the fact that there are people, there are organizations, there are groups that are specifically speaking out against what God has to say. Specifically speaking out against what the Bible says. So not only do we need to know scripture, but we need to be able to hear from God ourselves. Some of you guys are hearing me say this and you have absolutely zero confidence that that's possible. You have absolutely zero confidence. You think this is not for you. This is for like the five people that jump up and down up front with their hands up. This is about them. No, this is for every person in this room, because I believe that every person in this room is in this room because God loves you and God drew you and God wants you to be here. And if God drew you and wants you to be here, he wants to save you and rescue you and use you. And the way he uses you is by you hearing him and following his plan. So I want to discuss just real quick what happened with Samuel, because Samuel kept hearing this voice. Now, mind you, he's hearing an audible voice. He's hearing an audible voice at this point. It doesn't say that, but I'm going to assume it's an audible voice because he kept thinking it was Eli. So we're going to assume he was hearing the audible voice of God. And because he didn't recognize that voice, and because he had no experience hearing the voice of God, he was misplacing what he was hearing. And I think oftentimes we misplace what we hear. This isn't in the notes, but came to me. We misplace what we hear because sometimes we hear a certain thing from God and we run to a relationship instead. We hear something from God and we run full speed into that sport instead. Because we're hearing something, something's being downloaded and confirmed in us, but because we don't recognize it's the voice of God and that he, through his spirit and through his love, wants to lead you in a certain direction, we allow ourselves to, because we're not recognizing it, to run in the wrong direction like Samuel did instead of tuning our ear more to him. So I'm gonna give a lot of practical tonight. I think practical is important. So here's some common times to hear God. Common times to hear God. One, when we read his word. When we read the Bible. Why? Because the Bible is the word of God. So when we read the word of God, we have to understand God is speaking to us through his word. Whenever I read a verse, sometimes I have to remind myself, don't check out, don't consider it boring, don't consider it not for me. This every single word in this Bible is God speaking to me. Whether I feel like it's affecting my season or not, I've got to understand God is speaking to me. Well, that's one. Number two, when we pray and spend time with him, when we pray and spend time with him, God speaks. When we pray and spend time with him, God speaks. Number three, when his word is being preached. When his word is being preached. That's why half the time on Sundays I'm so distracted, because I'm texting half of you guys like, pay attention, put your phone away. But not because, now one part of that is because I think honor is a big deal, and I think we should honor who's speaking, you know, especially if it's, I mean, if it's, I'm not, it's hard for me to speak that about myself, but when your lead pastor is speaking, I think we should honor his voice. I think when a guest speaker is here speaking, I think we should honor their voice. You know, I don't want to go on a big round. You guys understand what I'm saying, though. Honor is a big deal for us. So that's one thing. But also, too, I'm texting you or bugging you or tapping you or whatever else because of honor, but also because I am desperate for you to hear the voice of God. And I firmly believe that because God downloads these messages into preachers, that God wants to speak to you through the preacher. How about when we worship? When we worship. I'm gonna tell a story. I didn't ask permission to tell this story, but I'm gonna tell it anyway. There was one time that a student here was going through something and kind of shaking it off. Like, it was a tough situation, but that person was, I firmly believe, shaking it off. I knew that person was shaking it off and not taking it seriously. And no joke, I think it was the first song of worship, that person absolutely crumbled and fell apart. Crumbled and fell apart in the worship. And it was partially a sad cry, but I knew more it was partially, not partially, it was in response to the Holy Spirit downloading something in that person saying, we're going to deal with this. Now, whether that person understands or not, in that moment in worship, God spoke. And God spoke and said, it stops now. We're going to face this now. We're going to deal with this now. And that person's walking in freedom now. So what I want you guys to understand, it's not always going to be a Nathan. But it might be a moment in worship where God just drops something in your heart. And we're going to get to the practical stuff, but drop something in your heart. And it's like, okay, you spoke, God, and I'm going to respond. I'm going to listen. All right? Another one is when we are having conversations with fellow believers, when we're having conversations with fellow believers, oftentimes when you're talking one believer to another, when you're sitting with maybe your small group leader, when you're sitting just with another Christian and you're having conversations, oftentimes they will speak something into your life that they think was just a really nice encouragement, but you knew it was the exact thing you needed to hear. God spoke through that person. Some of you guys have probably reached back out to that person and said, you don't know this, but God spoke through you. Right there, eating that Chick-fil-A, you know? When we're having conversations with other believers, God speaks. One more thing I just kind of wanted to throw in, because it's a huge challenge for me personally, I think it's a huge challenge for our generation, and I think it just should be pointed out, God speaks when we decide to be still. God speaks when we're in motion, but God speaks when we decide to be still. Because there's so many devices and so many people fighting for our attention. There's so many apps, there's so many speakers, there's so many people fighting for our attention. Oftentimes, in order to hear the voice of God, we actually need to make a decision to just stop and be still. You guys with me? Okay, now I'm gonna describe the hearing. I'm gonna describe the hearing because some of you guys are like, okay, if it's not an audible voice, then what does hearing God actually mean? Help me understand that, okay? We're not all Taylor Clarkson. We're not all on the mountaintop experience just constantly just being downloaded with the word, you know, coming down with tablets, all right? But here's some of them. Okay, one, there are people who hear an audible voice of God. That's an actual thing. Our lead pastor, but here's the thing. Don't feel bad if you never experienced that. I've been around church my entire life, been following Jesus since around, like 2013, been a pastor for 5.5 years, never heard the audible voice of God, not once. Our lead pastor's been doing it much longer than me. He's heard the audible voice of God twice. I'm not saying that God's not speaking audibly. I'm not saying that's not something that you should desire, but don't feel condemned, guilty, or like something's wrong with you if you don't hear the audible voice of God, but that is a thing. Okay, another one. You experience a holy conviction. A holy conviction. How many understand there's a difference between guilt and conviction? All right? Some convicted people right now. Guilt and conviction. Guilt is what the enemy wants to make you feel when you've done something wrong and wants to keep you there. Conviction is what the Holy Spirit makes you feel, and the Holy Spirit also says, I'm bringing you here and I'm going to take you out of here because of who Jesus is. Conviction, guilt sets you back. Conviction pushes you forward towards Jesus. And oftentimes the Lord speaks through holy conviction, meaning this. I don't know if this is going to be good video, Chris, because it's kind of ranty. And okay. All right. He's my confidence back there. I don't know how many of you guys have felt a holy conviction at a party. I don't know how many times I've felt a holy conviction when I rolled my window down at the red light, you know, and I'm about to tell something to the person that cut me off. But those times, as much as I think I just stopped myself, there's a holy conviction. And I didn't hear the voice of God, but I felt something say, stop. Nope. Put that down. Get out of this car. Turn the lights back on. Delete that app. Close the laptop. You guys with me? All four of you saved ones. Here's another one. God, we know we're hearing the voice of God, or the way God speaks is you experience an unexplainable peace. You experience an unexplainable peace. I love how the Bible talks about joy unspeakable. There's times when God speaks because you experience an unexplainable peace. Oftentimes, when you hear leaders have conversations, or you know, there's times where I've talked to Elder Andy about this and some of the other people that mentor me, and they'll say, when you made that decision, did you know it was the right one, or how did you know it was the right decision? And I said, as we were moving forward in that decision, I felt a peace that I couldn't explain. And oftentimes they'll say, okay, well, that's the direction you go. Because I'm not gonna say felt, I'm not gonna say the, because if I say the decision made me happy, that might be a red flag. If I say everyone agreed with the decision, that could still be a red flag. But an unexplainable peace after being in prayer, not an unexplainable peace because everybody pumped me up and said, do it, but an unexplainable peace after being with the Lord, moving forward in that decision. Another one, you experience an unexplainable joy. A joy that you believe you shouldn't have, but you have it in a season or a moment where most people wouldn't have joy, you're experiencing unexplainable joy. This message, a lot of this message can be about the Holy Spirit, to be honest, but as we know, God is three in one, and God often uses the Spirit to whisper, to speak, to comfort, and that's his voice. One more thing, and honestly, I firmly believe that this is often what leads you guys to make a decision for Jesus, to invite your friends, to stop doing this, to start doing that, is you understand that God spoke, or an example of hearing from God is you experience a call to action. So how many of you have ever, and this one I kind of do want a response, how many of you have ever been in a situation where you were pretty sure it was a God moment, you weren't sure if it was a God moment, but regardless, you just knew, I had to tell this person this. I had to encourage that person. I didn't have enough money, but I had to give that money to that person. I didn't have the gas, but I had to go give that ride. Everyone probably was gonna make fun of me, but I had to pray for that person in that moment. You guys with me? Hearing the voice of God, you know it's oftentimes when you hear the voice of God, it just prompts you, it calls you to action. It calls you to action. Two takeaways and I'm done. You guys okay? We good? All right. Two takeaways and I'm done. Two takeaways, I think, when it comes to hearing God, because I hope and pray we all have that desire. I hope and pray, considering the fact that he's the creator of the universe and willing to talk to you, I hope you're willing to listen to him. Can you imagine if you're, any TikTokers, you guys use TikTok? Maybe not, you're not, I don't know how to get these phrases right. Like, is a TikToker a person that uses it, or TikTok's a person that's like doing it? Which, okay, so what about a person that just uses it and scrolls through it? What do you call that person? A person that has TikTok. I should have practiced this. Okay, anyone use TikTok? All right. Some of you boys, okay. All right, Instagrammers, I'm old, I'm there. Okay. Can you imagine? Now, when you're trying to figure out how to navigate your TikTok, or how to use a new filter, or how to post something, or how to use, I don't know, guys. You guys get what I'm saying? When you're trying to figure out how to use it, what if you're struggling with it? How do you figure out how to use it? Like if you don't know how to, you say it, you download it and it has new features, how do you figure out how to use new features? You just figure it out? You just mess with it and figure it out? There's tutorials? Or you just ask one of your friends who knows what they're doing? What if your friend was the person who invented it? What if your friend was the person who created it? What if your friend can tell you the direction it's gonna go down the line? What if your friend can tell you what actually would be the best purpose for you to use your TikTok and Instagram? You guys get what I'm saying? Because that's, when it comes to the creator of the universe, that's who we have the opportunity to hear from and talk to. He created you. He knows what you're gonna be doing 10 years from now. And we have the opportunity to talk to him and hear from him. I think we should take advantage of that. Yeah. All right, I made it. Okay, so the two takeaways. One, before we talk about what's coming in, and before we talk about the healthy stuff, let's talk about the negative stuff. I think it's important that you guys guard your ear. Guard your ear. Your ear is being competed for. Take ownership of it. Be intentional about who and what you listen to. Consider and when you're talking about that, when you're thinking about the people you listen to, I'm gonna ask you to do this. Consider the fruit of the person's life. And if you're new to church, I'm not talking about apples and bananas. When I talk about the fruit of a person's life, when I say that, I'm saying consider, where is this person at in their life? What have they produced? I'm looking at them for some measure of success. You know, I hate to use this example, but I don't want a 350-pound trainer at the gym who's got like donut crumbs on his chest and, you know, his belly's popping out of his shirt and he's like, hey, bro, come get on the treadmill, I got you. Like, I'm looking at the fruit in his life, lack of fruit. Anyway. But I'm looking for the fruit in someone's life. Here's the deal. Don't take a relationship advice from the angry single person. I don't know how I landed there, but it was happening. I feel like I'm preaching to the girls too much. Hi, guys. How are you? I'm going to say some boy stuff now, bro. Look at the person's fruit in their life. Here's the other thing. Consider the dynamic of their relationship with you. Consider the dynamic of the relationship they have with you. Here's the deal. Just because they're your new best friend doesn't mean they have to be the person giving you all the advice. Consider the dynamic if this is your friend giving you advice and they don't like your parents. Consider the dynamic that they're giving you advice and they actually have a crush on you. All right. Consider the dynamic if they give you advice based on, as you can read, how it affects them. And one more thing, this is much less but just consider their availability to you. Don't lend your ear, don't lend your heart, don't lend don't tune your ear towards someone that you have to beg for their time. Okay? Consider their availability to you. All right. Thanks, boys. Good talking to you. Good to see you guys. Richard, congratulations on your offer. That a boy. Manager, agent, youth pastor. All right. Okay, here we go. Tune your ears to the voice of God. Takeaway number one, guard your ear. Takeaway number two, tune your ear to the voice of God. How are we going to do that? Plain and simple. Number one, stay alert and pay attention. Stay alert and pay attention. I'm gonna tell you guys something. Nope, I don't have my phone. I'm gonna tell you guys something. City Youth is absolutely known for serving well. We are absolutely known for serving well. Every time we have guests come here, they're like, you guys don't ever have to do a student takeover because your services already have a bunch of students serving all over the place, right? We're known for serving well. City Youth is known for having an incredible worship culture. We're all about it in worship. City Youth is going to be known for not checking out in messages. We're gonna read our Bibles. We're gonna open them during the message. We're gonna take notes during the message. We're gonna let the conversation wait during the message, okay? Stay alert, pay attention. Next one, be appropriately active when God is speaking. Take notes, voice messages, whatever you have to do. I even mean this when people go, like some of you guys may go like on a prayer walk or you feel like you're listening to a worship song in your car and you're like, man, God's saying something. I'm gonna give myself a voice message or I probably shouldn't tell you to text, but you guys get what I'm saying. Be appropriately active. Do the things that are gonna help you remember, retain, or save for later. Some of us, probably more the people that are older, you've had points where you've taken notes on something God said and it didn't mean much to you in the moment, but later on you went back to that and you're like, oh, now I know what that means, all right? Okay, and then the other one is this, be appropriately still when God is speaking. Give him some true space. Give him some space. Give him some time. All right, clear yourself. Guys, let's be honorable when God speaks. I think God can speak to you on your walk to school, on your drive to school. I think God can speak to you in a moment of worship here in this building, in a moment of worship in your room, driving, listening to worship music. I think God can speak to you on the football field when you want to quit. I think God can speak to you when you're crying in your room after the breakup. I think God can speak to you in the moments when you find out about your parents' divorce. God can speak to you no matter what, no matter when. Are we willing to listen? Are we tuning our ears to him? Sometimes God speaks just through a nudge. God speaks through another person's voice. God speaks through the preacher. God speaks through the stillness. God speaks through the peace that you experience. God speaks through the joy. Let's stand to our feet. So in order to hear the voice of God, we've got to know him. We have to know God in order to hear his voice, and we know God by accepting Jesus as Lord and Savior. Some of you guys may say, I'm not Christian enough for this to be available to me. As soon as you say yes to Jesus, you are Christian enough for the rest of your life. As soon as you say yes to Jesus, you are Christian enough. In fact, if you say yes to Jesus tonight and make him the Lord and Savior of your life, which I can go on a whole other thing that sometimes a lot of us want Jesus to be our Savior, but not our Lord. Savior, yes, rescue, but not Lord, guide me. But if you make Jesus your Lord and Savior, you are just as much saved as every elder and pastor in this room. You guys understand what I'm saying? Because Jesus says that if you confess with your mouth, believe with your heart, you shall be saved. Bible talks about, and the Apostle Paul wrote it in Romans, he says, being saved just means that you believe that Jesus died for you in your place, and that he rose again, and now he's in heaven, saving a place for you that you don't deserve, that you didn't earn, but because God loved you so much, he sent his son. So we have the opportunity to hear from the Creator. Every single person in this room has so many decisions to make over the next few years. Some of you guys have decisions to make of what you're gonna do with your summer. Some of you guys are navigating a really good relationship right now. Some of you guys are navigating a really tough relationship right now. Some of you guys are trying to figure out how to navigate your relationship with your parents. Some of you guys are trying to figure out what you wanna do with your life. Some of you guys are dealing with some hurts and some wounds. If I'm saying anything about, if that's you right now, you've gotta hear the voice of God. You've gotta hear the voice of God. Why? Because he knows what's on the other end of that decision already. He knows what's on the other end of that relationship already. He knows how he's gonna protect and guard you through that messy divorce. He knows how you're going to heal from the pain that you have in your body already. So let's hear from him. All right, let's close our eyes. Lord, I thank you so much. I thank you so much for your kids. I thank you so much for your leaders. I thank you so much for every one of your children that are here tonight. I pray, Lord, if there's anybody here who doesn't know you, I pray, Holy Spirit, that you reveal yourself to them. Even in this moment, reveal yourself to them with the peace that only you can give, with the joy that only you can give. I also pray tonight that, Lord, we truly take what you have to say in your word, how we can learn from Samuel that though there's times we hear that, we learn to position ourselves and listen. Position ourselves and listen to your voice. Lord, I love how it says in Samuel that it was uncommon at the time for people to hear from God. I think it's uncommon for teenagers to hear from God now, but I believe you have that anointing on City Youth students. I believe that anointing is here tonight. I believe that anointing is available to these students, to these leaders. So I pray, Holy Spirit, that tonight we leave here changed. Tonight we leave here eager to position ourselves to hear from you, eager to worship, eager to position ourselves to hear from the word, eager to have good, healthy conversations, eager to speak out when we know that you're giving us a word, giving us some encouragement to give to someone else. We thank you that you're a God that speaks to us. We thank you that because Jesus died on the cross, we can have salvation. And it also says the veil was torn so that we can be in direct relationship and communion with you. Lord, I pray that you speak tonight through these groups. Let us be open. Let us be clear. Let us hear from you. In Jesus' name, amen.